Welcome, everybody. I'm Adam Goodhart, director of the Star Center here at Washington College, and it is really a great pleasure to welcome Kate Larson back to Chestertown and back to Washington College. It's been a few years since she's been here, but we welcome her back like an old friend. One of the Star Center's central missions, as you know, is to support and showcase authors whose work speaks to audiences beyond just academia, while also maintaining the very highest scholarly standards. We also believe very strongly in work that connects the past and the present, not in sort of glib ways, but rather by telling stories from the past as a way of addressing issues and questions in the current day. And in all of these arenas, Kate Larson and her work are truly exemplary. She is the author, as I'm sure you're familiar with, of three critically acclaimed biographies: Rosemary, The Hidden Kennedy Daughter, which we will be hearing about shortly, Bound for the Promised Land, Harriet Tubman, Portrait of an American Hero, and The Assassin's Accomplice, Mary Surratt and the Plot to Kill Abraham Lincoln. Her Harriet Tubman biography, of course, will be especially vivid, I'm sure, and important for many of you in this room, as it has been for many of us on the Eastern Shore, because not only did Kate Larson take this life that had been shrouded in so much mystery and myth and mystification, really, for a century and a half, and peeled all of that away and revealed a woman underneath who was certainly more three-dimensional and also more extraordinary than her legend had suggested. But also she made great things happen here on the Eastern Shore of Maryland, especially with her role in the creation of the Harriet Tubman Underground Railroad National Monument, which is a great treasure now for the Eastern Shore and for which alone I think Kate Larson deserves a round of applause from all of us. Kate has also been somebody who's been a leader in public history in many ways, again, reaching out and not simply writing history, but also engaging with the general public. She's been a consultant and interpretive specialist for numerous museum and public history initiatives, especially those focusing on the lives and contributions of women to our national story. Kate Larson's book reveals the life of another American woman, very different from Harriet Tubman, and whose life was shrouded in even more mystery and myth for many, many years, not to say deliberate concealment and obfuscation. Rosemary Kennedy's story is one of heartbreaking errors, betrayals, and belated and perhaps also incomplete attempts at redemption. The book spent 10 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list, and it's garnered some exceptional reviews, including this one from a critic at the National Review. Larson's style is so vivid and powerful that we want to read it through spread fingers like a jury looking at autopsy photos. I was wiped out when I finished the book. Here is a writer who rejects today's penny-ante responses of empathy and compassion and compels us instead to receive humanity's sacrament of pity. So please join me in welcoming Kate Larson.
Thank you, Adam. Can you all hear me okay? I have this thing on. Well, thank you for having me. It's a great pleasure to be back here in Chestertown and at Washington College, and I'm really happy to be here to talk about Rosemary Kennedy. So I'll tell you a little bit how I came to research her life and write about her, and then I will show you some pictures that cover a bit of her life, and I will tell you some of the things that I uncovered while doing my research on her. Back in 2005, Rosemary died. She was 86 years old, and there was a obituary, like a three-paragraph obituary in the Boston Globe, and I live in the Boston area. And as a New Englander, of course, I know about the Kennedys. I had read several of those Kennedy biographies over the years. And so when I read the obituary, there was just something about it that hit me. It was sad. There was so little to be known about her. I had been aware of Rosemary, but like everybody else, there was just so much that was missing. And I was working on another book project at the time, and I just put it in the back of my mind that I would perhaps look into her life. Fortunately, I live in Boston, and that's where the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library is. So I knew that I would have access to resources there. In 2008, my other project was done, and I started going to the Kennedy Library to start researching her life. And it was a fortuitous moment, because starting in 2007, the library had started opening up some of Rose Kennedy's journals and diaries that were held there at the library. The library holds not only our former president's collection of papers, but also some of his family papers, including the papers of his father, Joseph P. Kennedy, and his mother, Rose Fitzgerald Kennedy. And when those papers were gifted to the presidential library, they were gifted with an understanding of there would be a timetable when parts of the collections would be opened. So like over a 30-year period, they had set dates where certain things would be opened. Well, the date 2007-2008 was the time to start opening up Rose's papers. And there in the collection were some of Rosemary's letters that she had written as a child and a young woman. And it gave me this sense of Rosemary. It was her voice, and I could imagine her, I could feel her, and I could understand her a little bit. So I was hooked very, very quickly, and I knew that I had to research her life and write about her. I had no idea how much more I would find, but I did find a lot, and it took a very long time. 2 years into the project, my son was diagnosed with schizophrenia, and I had to take a hiatus for a couple of years. The interesting thing about that, though, it put me in the position of being the mother of a child with a very severe disability. So while I was on a track of being really very critical of Joe and Rose Kennedy, and certainly, you know, they have had a bad rap over the years, much of it self-inflicted on their part, and it made me pull back and look at them with a different lens. Ultimately, I think I found a balance, and you will be the judge. But this is what I learned about Rosemary. So let me just start here. Rosemary was born in September of 1918, and she was the third child of Rose and Joe Kennedy. Her two older brothers, Joe Jr. and Jack, who would become our president, were two rambunctious boys, and this little girl joined them. And Rose was absolutely thrilled that she had a daughter. Rose had sisters that she loved, and she just was thrilled to pieces to have a baby girl. The childbirth was a very difficult childbirth, and this is important to me because I think this gives us perhaps a clue as to what happened to Rosemary and why she was intellectually disabled. During the childbirth process, her obstetrician was delayed. It was going to be a home birth. Rose had an obstetrical nurse with her, and they were waiting for the doctor to arrive to deliver baby Rosemary. But the doctor was delayed because of the Spanish flu that was sweeping across the globe, and it had hit Boston particularly hard that fall, and he was delayed at the hospital treating many, many patients. The nurse, who had been trained how to deliver a baby, had also been trained to try and delay the birth as long as possible so that the doctor could deliver the baby and collect his fee. She told Rose to cross her legs and hold back the baby. Well, you know, that's impossible when you're in the throes of powerful labor. Then the nurse put her hand and held baby Rosemary back in the birth canal for 2 hours. The doctor arrives, yippee, helps baby Rosemary be born, everyone's relieved, oh yeah, they forget what horror had gone on there waiting for the doctor to arrive. Rosemary is sweet, she's a calm baby, no trouble, and Rose is thrilled. She just thinks she's got the sweetest baby on earth. Rosemary begins to grow as an infant, and Rose and Joe notice that she is not reaching some of the milestones that infants and toddlers reach at certain months and years. But Rose and Joe thought, well, they're kind of, their benchmark were these two boys who were very active and, you know, just out there doing everything very quickly. So they sort of pushed aside their concerns and their fears. But, you know, she's 2 years old, she's still having difficulty. At first she had a hard time sitting up. She had a hard time crawling and then learning to walk. She was very delayed in learning to talk. She had difficulty feeding herself. Then Rose and Joe have more children, and they notice that the other children are actually, you know, coming along very, very quickly, but Rosemary continues to be delayed. They enroll her in kindergarten in Brookline, Massachusetts, where they were living at the Edward Devotion School. And of course, immediately the teachers realize that Rosemary is delayed. They can compare her to other children that are other five-year-olds in the classroom. So they inform Rose and Joe, but Rose and Joe are hopeful that with enough teaching and guidance that Rosemary would be fine. Brookline was one of the first cities in the country to institute the IQ test. So Rosemary was given an IQ test, and I don't know what the number was, but Rose later said in an interview that the teachers told them that Rosemary's was a very low number. So they had confirmation that Rosemary was intellectually disabled, but Rose and Joe had lots of resources, and they were a family that did not want obstacles, and they were willing to plow through them. So Rosemary was kept back in kindergarten. The other children continued to progress as they normally would. Eventually, the Kennedys moved to New York, and they enroll Rosemary in public school like they had done in Brookline. But it becomes more of a problem because she's getting bigger and older, and she's not keeping up with her age group peers. The teachers are frustrated because in those days, the teachers were not equipped to take care of and help and educate children with intellectual disabilities. The classrooms were not set up like they are today. There were not special aids and other educational resources and tools for teachers, schools, and parents at the time. So the schools were frustrated. Rose and Joe Kennedy were frustrated. They hired private tutors to work with Rosemary when she got home from school. They worked with her physically. They played extra rounds of tennis with her. And all of the children were raised to accommodate Rosemary, and this becomes important as they grow into adulthood. But all the children were required to include Rosemary in everything they did. If she couldn't play tennis very well, they helped her. She couldn't really sail a boat, but she was the crew, and they helped her sail. Everything they did included Rosemary, and they accommodated her slowness. Physically, she was slower, and intellectually. As Rosemary aged, though, during her childhood, she began to notice that she, too, was she was different than her siblings and other children, and she started getting frustrated and acting out. Here are some pictures of Rosemary with her sisters, Kathleen Kick, who was born about a year and a half after Rosemary, and Eunice, who was born almost 3 years later. So the picture on your left is Rosemary, Kick, and then Eunice, and then the other one is Rosemary with Eunice. Eunice and Rosemary would become incredibly close as teenagers, young adults, and then later in their advanced years. As I mentioned before, Rosemary had difficulties physically, and she may have also had dyslexia in addition to the intellectual disabilities. She had difficulty riding a bicycle. She couldn't steer a sled on a snowy hill. She had difficulty with left and right. When she did start writing, she did a lot of mirror writing, which is typical of some people with dyslexia. So at the time, though, there was very little diagnosis to give any guidance. And even if she had been diagnosed with dyslexia, there really were no tools at the time in the 1920s to help her. But the tutors worked with her and worked with her. And so did Rose. Rose spent a lot of time personally with Rosemary trying to help her. And as I said, she was very close with her siblings, the Kennedys, Joe and Rose. Wanted those children to grow up as each other's best friend, that family was everything. Family was first. You relied on your family members for everything. Friends were great, but family was first. And this is how Rosemary was brought up, included in everything. She was not separated for years, she was part of everything. These are photographs from, they had a home in Cohasset, Massachusetts. Eventually, they bought a magnificent compound in Hyannisport, Massachusetts to spend their summers. So as Rosemary aged, and she's like in fourth grade in the schools in New York when they had moved to Riverdale in New York, and the teachers were telling Joe and Rose, this isn't working. So when Rosemary was 11 years old, in September of 1929, Joe and Rose sent her away to a school called the Devereux School in Philadelphia. It was run by a woman by the name of Helen Devereux, who had been instrumental in instituting programs for intellectually disabled students in the Philadelphia school systems. It was very experimental. And she was quite successful, so successful that she left the public school system and decided to open her own private residential school for wealthier families who wanted to send their children to her. And this is what Rose and Joe did. It was rather tragic, and reading letters from this time period from Rosemary are just heartbreaking. For anybody who has a child with intellectual or even physical disabilities, or any other types of disabilities, oftentimes there's an emotional immaturity as well and a sense of insecurity. Well, this was Rosemary. To send her away as an 11-year-old to a residential school was really, really difficult. She's intellectually disabled, emotionally immature, and she's taken away from this family that is this cocoon for her, this really supportive environment. She felt that she was being punished by being sent away. Now, while Helen Devereux might have been very successful in her programs, there were a couple things about her school that I found very upsetting. One was that the children all had to behave, which was a little difficult for Rosemary because sometimes she was quite full of it, and she also lashed out a lot. She would get very frustrated when she couldn't meet the expectations of her parents or her teachers, so she acted out a lot. So to be able to rein that in a new residential setting was bound to be difficult for Rosemary. So unfortunately, Rose and Joe did not take that into consideration when they sent her away. The letters that she writes are heartbreaking. You know, oh dear daddy, I miss you so much, please bring me home. Mrs. Devereux had a rule that if the students or a student did not do well in school, did not behave, they weren't allowed to go home for Thanksgiving. And Rosemary knew this, and she was quite a handful the first month or 6 weeks that she was at the school. Joe Kennedy wrote a letter, actually, to Rose, who was had this habit of going away on really long vacations a lot. And he wrote her a letter that fall, and he said, well, Rosemary raised Cain the first few weeks, but she's doing better, which was probably true. But Rosemary, and the teachers are sending letters saying, you know, Rosemary is a sweet girl, you know, she's learning to control her temper, but she's not doing so well in school. In the meantime, Rosemary is writing letters to her parents saying, she's being so good, and she's being perfect, and she's getting 100 in English, and 100 in math, and 100 in everything, when actually she's not getting good grades at all. She didn't understand that the teachers were actually letting her parents know that she wasn't doing well. So it was a very difficult 2 years for her. She did actually attain, I would estimate, a late third grade, early fourth grade education. That's probably where she stopped. Emotionally, she was probably about that age as well throughout her her young adulthood. This is a picture of her. She's a young teenager, maybe 12 or 13. And then the other one, she's at Hyannisport and she's reading a magazine. It's one of those Hollywood variety magazines with all the stars and their pictures in it. So she could read. It was with difficulty sometimes, but she certainly could read and write. So she was at the Devereux School for 2 years. And the Kennedys were frustrated because she didn't seem to be progressing, not understanding that given her disabilities, she probably wasn't going to progress much further. So from 1929 to 1938, she attended five different schools. They kept moving her from one school to the next, thinking the next school is the one that's going to do the trick. The Devereux School was the only school that was for children with intellectual disabilities. All the others were mainstream private schools, mostly Catholic convent schools like Sacred Heart Academies and the such. And the Kennedys did not really inform the administrators, or the teachers that Rosemary was intellectually disabled. They left it to the teachers to figure that out when Rosemary arrived, which was incredibly duplicitous of them. But they were the Kennedys, and by the 1930s, they were among the wealthiest people in the country. Joe, of course, was a brilliant financier. He had made millions of dollars in the stock market, and they were very, very wealthy. So, and they were powerful Catholics. So these Catholic schools were not going to say to Joe and Rose Kennedy, come get your daughter. You know, they'd rather take the money and then do what they needed to do to take care of Rosemary. And the nuns at these schools were lovely people, and they did care about Rosemary, but they could not teach her like they could teach the other young children and women at these schools. So it was a difficult go of it for Rosemary. She cherished her vacations and summertime with her family. This is a beautiful photograph of the whole family. I think Teddy is the only one that's not in this photograph, Senator Ted Kennedy, but this is at Hyannisport. Rosemary is in the far right-hand lower corner. And that's Jack that's up high on the left. Here is a letter that she wrote when she was 16 years old. I believe somebody probably worked with her on this because the writing is so straight. She often wrote, you know, at very pronounced angles, and she would drift around the papers a lot. So someone probably worked with her to help her read this. See, she says, I get lonesome every day, you know, dear daddy. When she wrote to her mother, actually most of the children, when they wrote to their mother, they said, dear mother. But every time they wrote to Joe, it was dear daddy. You know, I love you, daddy, but they didn't do that to Rose. She was much more distant, a caring woman. She loved her children, but Joe was very demonstrative with his children. He was very affectionate with them, and they responded in kind to him. So as she aged and they moved her to different schools, she just became more and more frustrated. And from the research that I did in the library, and by the way, over the years, more and more of the papers were opened. You know, from between 2008 and 2014, more and more collections, portions of the collections were opened so I could see more and more papers. So it became more apparent that Rosemary seemed to be suffering from mental health issues as well. Not just frustration and lashing out, but more prominent mental health issues. She would have these rages and she would have to be sedated. She was in Boston at one point at a school, and it was run by a woman and her daughter. And so it was like a one-on-one type of school. Actually, it was a school for gifted children. But they took Rosemary on and worked with her one-on-one, and it was marginally successful. But while she was in Boston during the mid-1930s, Joe had heard about a doctor who was an endocrinologist, a famous endocrinologist, who felt that he could cure children like Rosemary with hormone injections. So he convinced Rose and Joe to let him inject Rosemary with hormones once a week. And in one of the letters he wrote to Joe, he said, I guarantee in 9 months she will be 100%. You know, this poor kid was being experimented on. And of course, hormones were not going to improve her intellectual abilities at all. So she endured these hormone injections. She's a teenage girl. I can't imagine the havoc those hormones might have been having on her body, on her brain. Who knows what they were injecting her with. So this continues. She goes to different schools. Rose and Joe are even more duplicitous than ever, and the teachers are writing these letters. They're angry that they feel that they've been betrayed by the Kennedys, who did not tell them how much work it was to take care of Rosemary. And as Rosemary aged, she would take off. she would run away. And so she's at a school in New York City, and she takes off in New York City, and her parents are frantic because the Great Depression, there was the kidnapping craze that was on. And of course, they're a very wealthy family. What if Rosemary, who was turning into a beautiful young woman, was lured by some man? And they just had all these scary scenarios they were frightened by. And they were not telling these administrators and teachers that Rosemary needed a lot more care. And they actually didn't really look for an appropriate setting for her, I felt. They just kept believing that somehow Rosemary was going to be better. And it was somebody else's problem, particularly Rose. She just didn't want to have to deal with it anymore. But in 1938, Joe was appointed the ambassador to Great Britain. And he had been very close to FDR, and this was sort of, he had been very supportive in helping him campaign, so this was his reward. Well, Rose Kennedy was thrilled. They would be the first Irish Catholics appointed to this post, and Rose and Joe felt this would be a remarkable opportunity for their children, particularly their boys, Joe and Jack. So they get all the family together and they sail over to England. And Rosemary and Eunice were the last to go over there in April of 1938. Here's a picture of Eunice and Rosemary on the left. They're on the a ship waiting to sail. And there's a picture of Kick, who now is a lovely young woman as well. When they arrive in London, Kick and her two brothers sort of become they're on the society pages all the time. They're active, they're social, they're handsome, beautiful, and all the British elite want to invite them to all their parties, which turns out to be a problem for Rosemary. Here's a picture of them all in England at the ambassador's residence. It's a very famous photograph. It's a beautiful photograph, all of them together. I can tell you it's Eunice and Jack, Rosemary, Jean, Joe, Teddy, Rose, Joe Jr., Patricia, Bobby, and Kick, or Kathleen at the end. Beautiful family. And Rose she had been raised in a political family. Her father, Honey Fitz, had been mayor of Boston, and politics had been his life, and she knew how to be the political wife. And being in London, the ambassador's wife, was a dream come true for her. Within a couple of weeks of arriving in London, it was the formal presentation at the Court of St. James, where young eligible women and their mothers were presented to the King and Queen of England. And of course, as the ambassador's wife, Rose was invited, as were her two daughters, Kick and Rosemary. Rose ordered magnificent designer gowns for the girls, and as you can see, you know, they're beautiful. This photograph with the photographers, actually there are like three or four rows of photographers taking pictures of them. It was such a big deal for this family to be in London. And Rosemary became a favorite of the photographers because she was so beautiful. And as you can see, she's got a little bit of that spunk to her in the photograph in the right-hand corner. You know, they just loved her. She had this beautiful smile. But the 2 weeks leading up to the presentation, the court presentation, they drilled Rosemary on the proper curtsy, the right phrases to use, how to hold her bouquet, all the things that she had to do. And it was difficult for her to learn this, and they had to drill her over and over again. She curtsied in front of the king and queen. She stumbled a tiny bit, but she held herself and she pulled it off, so it was a great relief. But Rose was always worried, so was Joe, that someone would discover that Rosemary was intellectually disabled, because if you carried on a conversation with her, you would figure that out very quickly. So Rose and Joe had made a practice of keeping her controlled and not out in the public very much. So when they're in London, that was going to be a problem. And Eunice later said in an interview that she and Kick would have to go to parties with her, so would her brothers, but Kick and Eunice were always afraid they'd have to watch her constantly. If Rosemary tried to reapply her lipstick, she would always smear it and not know it, so they would have to catch her first and then apply the lipstick for her. It was just this dance that all the siblings had to do to protect Rosemary, sort of from herself, but also from prying eyes and the public. When they were at dances, Joe and Jack filled her dance card. And as an older, you know, a young adult woman, she started to get irritated at that. Like, why only my brother's dancing me? Why can't that handsome boy over there dance with me? Sometimes they would recruit their closest friends to dance with Rosemary. But Rosemary, she was a young woman. She liked to flirt. She liked the attention of men. So she wanted to dance with them and not her brothers all the time. So it was a frustrating experience for her to be in the social environment. So eventually they stopped letting her go to parties and events in London. Here she is in a couple just other ambassadorial events. And I'm not sure if you can see this very well in this photograph, but the photograph on the left where she's standing there with her father, Joe, and he has this sort of unnatural grip on her arm. And there are several photographs like that, and I have two of them in my book, this one and there's another one. And it's just like, you know, he's holding her back, not a casual hooking his arm around his daughter's arm. It's always controlled that way. And Eddie Moore is the older man who's sitting at the table with her, and he was Joe Kennedy's right-hand man, and he was also Rosemary's godfather. And he and his wife, Mary Moore, spent a lot of time with Rosemary, particularly in Europe. They traveled with her, they monitored her care, they were very, very close to her. They were sort of substitute parents for her. And as you can see, she's just stunningly beautiful. This is, she's traveling around Ireland at this time. Photographers are everywhere. Eunice writes letters about how many photographers are dogging them everywhere they go. And this is one of the reasons, because Rosemary was so beautiful. But they had to control things that she said. Here's Kick and her two brothers, Joe and Jack. They were in the society pages all the time, going to all the parties as well. Kick would eventually marry the heir to a great fortune. He was a duke who would die in World War II, unfortunately. And there's another picture of Rosemary with her father, and there he is again with this awkward kind of grasp on her arm. That was for an opening at the London Zoo. But these are some of the very few public photographs of Rosemary during that time. They took the children on tours of Europe, and Rosemary always went along, but they had Eddie and Mary Moore with them to help with Rosemary, as well as young women that they hired to be companions with Rosemary, so that the kids also could do other things like skiing in the Swiss Alps. Rosemary couldn't ski, so Rose would send Rosemary to a spa to have massages and things like that with an escort, and the kids could go skiing and not worry about Rosemary. One of the wonderful things that happened to Rosemary, though, in England is they assigned her, the Kennedys put her in a convent school, an Assumption convent school in London, and it was run by a woman by the name of Mother Isabel Eugenie. And Mother Isabel had been trained personally by Maria Montessori, who created the Montessori educational method. So when Rosemary attended this Assumption school, Mother Isabel sort of took a special interest in Rosemary and applied those Montessori educational methods to training and teaching Rosemary, who's now 20 years old, by the way. And she had miraculous results. Rosemary calmed down. She felt successful, competent. She had goals that she could actually meet and attain. And they were simple things like counting the dishes for dinner, and then cleaning them, counting them again, and then putting them on the shelf. Simple things, and she would be rewarded for that, and they would clap and be happy that she could do things like that. Just simple things. And one stepping stone led to the other. Rosemary was incredibly happy at this school. She only came home to the ambassador's residence periodically, because they discovered that when she was came back into the fold with all the other kids, she would lash out and be frustrated. They're going to parties. She would have to be babysitting the younger kids, or it was just too much of a jarring thing to transition once again, because transitions were very hard for Rosemary. Unfortunately, World War II intervened. Otherwise, I think Rosemary would have had a remarkably happy life in London and in England. In 1939, in the fall of 1939, the Kennedys decided to send all the children back to the States. It was getting too dangerous. Rose followed them, and Joe decided to stay behind. And they agreed to keep Rosemary in England until it was absolutely much too unsafe. So she felt pretty special to stay, because they convinced her that she was staying to keep her father company on weekends. So she was thrilled to stay in England. But by May of 1940, they knew it was too late. They needed to send her home. So they sent her back to the United States with Mary and Eddie Moore. Here they are again with her. And this marks the beginning of the end for Rosemary. Rose decided that she had to have Rosemary taken care of that summer of 1940. And Rose was not good at taking care of Rosemary. She got too upset by Rosemary. Rosemary got upset by her. So Rose contacted two women, Carolyn and Grace Sullivan in Massachusetts, who ran a camp for girls in Western Massachusetts. Their father had been a friend of Rose's father. So she went to them and said, I have this 22-year-old daughter who has been trained as a teacher. She could be a junior counselor for her. Will you hire her? And so they're like, you know, wow, the Kennedys, okay, sure. So Rosemary arrives at the camp, and within a matter of days, Carolyn and Grace realize, uh-oh, this is not good. Rosemary needed more care than some of their children did, the young girls that they had at the camp. Here's a picture of her at the camp and a letter that she wrote to the Sullivan sisters. I got access to this. Interestingly, I live in a town called Winchester in Massachusetts, and somehow it got out that I was writing this book, and a neighbor of mine called me. And she is the daughter of Carolyn Sullivan. And she had all these letters and photographs that her mother had given her and had told her stories about Rosemary at the camp. I didn't get these from the Kennedy Library. And she told me that her mother and her aunt were so furious with Rose Kennedy that she lied to them. Not only did she lie to them about Rosemary's capabilities, when Carolyn and Grace called Rose and said, you need to come and get Rosemary because we're exhausted. You know, Rosemary is going off in the middle of the night. We have to block the door to keep her in. You know, this is not working. Rose said, basically, too bad. And she went to Maine to the Elizabeth Arden Spa. So the Sullivan sisters were, so they're frantic. Eventually, Eddie Moore gets Rosemary from the camp. She's there about a month, and he brings her to Philadelphia, and he enrolls her in Ravenhill Assumption Academy School there. Now, Ravenhill was a very elite Catholic school. Princess Grace went there, Corazon Aquino there, lots of very wealthy, prominent women from around the world went to the school. It was not appropriate for Rosemary. So she leaves there sometime in September. Joe is back from England at some point, and they enroll her in a series of other Catholic schools over the next year. In the fall of 1941, Rose tries to have Rosemary committed to a psychiatric hospital. I don't know what the trigger was for this moment. I wasn't surprised when I came across that in the Kennedy Library. But something must have seriously happened for Rose to consider a psychiatric institutionalization. But that didn't happen. What did happen is that Joe decided to have Rosemary lobotomized. She was at a convent school in Washington, D.C. She was escaping at night. The nuns were frantic. They'd go out looking for her. They'd find her. She'd have had a few drinks. Her clothes would be a mess. She'd have leaves in her hair. And so, of course, naturally, everybody's thinking and worrying about the worst, that she was meeting young men, that she could be caught in a compromising situation. So there were these two doctors who were practicing at George Washington University Hospital at the time, Dr. James Watts and Walter Freeman. And they were pioneers in this country of the prefrontal lobotomy, which was a procedure that had been started in Europe in the 1930s. And they claimed that it could help people with mental health issues and intellectual disabilities. In 1941, they had done, maybe in the fall of 1941, they had done probably about 75 procedures at George Washington University Hospital. In the spring of that year, there was an article in the Saturday Evening Post. It was a big article about these two doctors and their pioneering research. And the doctors talked about how they perform this procedure where they cut the frontal lobes and they return people to their full independent lives. They're happy, they're not tormented anymore, and they had great success rates. That summer, the American Medical Association came out and said, no, this should not be done, this surgery is too experimental. We're cautioning it, you know, we're telling people they shouldn't do it. There should be more research before people submit their loved ones or themselves to this procedure. But James Watts and Walter Freeman are out there, oh, it's such a successful operation. Well, when I went to research their actual research documents, they were telling a lie. Most of their patients did not come out of the surgery independent, happy, you know, liberated. Most of them could not live independent lives afterwards. Many of them were not tormented anymore, certainly, but they could not live independently. Some were horribly disabled, and some died. But they didn't tell the public that. So Joe is considering this operation for Rosemary. I don't know how he approached the doctors. I'm not clear on how that happened. I had some speculation. It's in the book. Rose actually approached their daughter, Kick, who was then a reporter in Washington, D.C., and asked her to investigate the procedure. So Rose knew what was going on. Kick investigated it, came back, and said to her mother, oh, Mom, we don't want to do this for Rosie. It's just bad. The results are not good. Just before Thanksgiving, Rosemary was forced to have a lobotomy. She came out of the surgery completely and totally disabled. She couldn't walk or talk. She was incontinent. She couldn't do anything. She couldn't feed herself, nothing. So the doctors made a mistake, clearly. She was so physically disabled as well as more intellectually disabled. Joe put her in a psychiatric hospital called the Craig House in Beacon, New York, and she was there for 7 years. And in 1949, she got some rehab, physical rehabilitation, but she still was not progressing very well. His children's careers were taking off. He was concerned about them, so he wanted Rosemary hidden away. Eventually, he transferred her to St. Colette's School for the Disabled in Jefferson, Wisconsin, another Catholic institution, and she spent the rest of her life there. It was a wonderful institution, very caring nuns, really great health care. The fact that she lived to be 86 years old is really remarkable and a testament to the quality of care that the Kennedys could pay for. And interestingly, going through the letters in the collections, the nuns were very loving and caring with Rosemary. And they got to know her probably better than anybody. Rose did not see her daughter for 20 years. 1962 is when she finally went to visit Rosemary for the first time. I think Joe saw Rosemary a couple of times when she was at the Craig House in the early 1940s. but then he never saw her again. He had a stroke in 1961. He couldn't really walk or talk very well after that, and he died in 1969 without ever seeing her again. Jack went to see her for the first time in 1958 when he was campaigning, and he was in Wisconsin, and he took a secret trip to see her. He spent a few hours there, and then he left. Clearly, it affected him. Eunice said in an interview that she had no idea where Rosemary was for 10 years. Those kids had been told not to ask. Ted Kennedy, in his memoir, wrote that he was 9 years old when Rosemary disappeared. And he said that he knew that he better behave, because if he didn't, he might disappear too. Can you imagine? So I don't know exactly when Eunice actually saw Rosemary for the first time. Kick died in 1948 in a plane crash. Joe Jr. died in World War II in a plane crash. So I'm not sure when Eunice finally saw Rosemary, but it was probably around between 58 and 62. So Rosemary, when she did see her mother for the first time, hit her. She was so angry. Rosemary knew who she was. She never forgot that. She knew who her siblings were, her parents were. That was never lost. She just couldn't communicate very well. In fact, one of the letters I read is one of the, they had hired a new doctor at the school, and the doctor wrote that they stopped giving Rosemary some medication that she had been taking since she had come from the Craig house. So they stopped giving her the medication, and she started to talk. So she couldn't carry on a huge conversation, but she could put words together and make her wants and wishes known. Here's a picture of Jack handing a pen to Eunice after he signed some important legislation for establishing resource centers and communities for families and people with disabilities. He also signed lots of legislation to fund research into the causes of intellectual and physical disabilities. And all of it was really because of Eunice. Eunice was the powerhouse behind the family committing itself to research and resources for people with disabilities. They had established a foundation after Joe Jr. died, and Joe Sr. put millions of dollars into it. And during the late 40s and early 1950s, a lot of the funds in that foundation went to Catholic charities and poor relief. Well, Eunice went to her father and said, I want this changed. I want it to go into research and resources into intellectual disabilities. And so he gave her the reins to do that, and it changed the shift of the family focus of the foundation. She, of course, would go on to found Special Olympics. It's directly because of Rosemary. Remember, those kids grew up accommodating Rosemary, finding ways to include her in all their sports activities. Rosemary benefited from that, and Eunice knew that children around the world would benefit from the same types of activities and resources and inclusion. Jean, another sister, started Very Special Arts, which is an arts program for people with intellectual disabilities. Teddy, of course, he helped shepherd through hundreds of pieces of legislation linked to helping people with disabilities, intellectual, physical, mental health, including the Americans with Disabilities Act, along with Orrin Hatch and other senators. So he too, of course, was deeply influenced by Rosemary. After Joe died, Rose decided to have Rosemary come home for visits. So she would come home for a week visit at Hyannisport and a week visit at Palm Beach. And this gave many of the nieces and nephews an opportunity to get to know their aunt. And they loved her deeply. And she really enjoyed being with them and seeing them. The Shriver kids were probably, Eunice Kennedy Shriver's children, probably became the closest to Rosemary. In fact, I know that Anthony Shriver spent a lot of time with Rosemary. He would go to St. Coletta's. He would stay in the little house that Joe Kennedy had built for Rosemary and the nuns that took care of her. He built an addition to his own home in Miami, so when she came to visit with her nun nurses. They could stay there privately in his house. So all the nieces and nephews were profoundly affected by Rosemary and loved her deeply. And some of them have gone on to do important work as well for people with disabilities and more. Here's Anthony with one of the nuns and Rosemary. I think it's a birthday party, and this is a photograph. He gave me these to use in the book, and this one is beautiful of Rosemary. I think it's just lovely. This is the woman that he knew and all of those kids knew. And he started Best Buddies. I don't know if you have Best Buddies chapters down here. I'm sure you do. And there's, well, you guys might not like Tom Brady, but we love him. So Rosemary, this is her legacy. What happened to her was horrifying. It should never have happened to her. But it did, but it transformed her siblings who went on to do remarkable things and who have made our world for people with disabilities and their families a much better place. And for that, we have to thank Rosemary. Thank you. Do you have any questions? Don't be shy. Yes.
Have they ever found out if lobotomies did anybody any good?
Actually, they did do good for some people, but very few. And the procedure that Rosemary had was the early procedure where they drilled in the side of the skull on both sides. Later, Dr. Freeman would develop that famous ice pick, and he would take an ice pick, gold-plated, and put it in the eye socket and do his procedure that way. He did thousands of them. Eventually, medicine changed that because people who had mental health issues could turn to drugs. In the 1950s, that started happening. He kept doing the procedure through the 1960s. It's important to note that in the 1940s, there were no patient protections in place. Doctors really could experiment like this, and there were no patient advocates, there were no scientific guidelines, there were no research guidelines, there were no clinical trials back then, and at the time, women were incredibly vulnerable. Something like 80% of lobotomies were performed on women, when they were actually only 60% of psychiatric hospitalizations. And a father, a brother, a husband, a son could commit a woman in their life and have them have a lobotomy against their will. So fortunately, those things have changed. A lot of patient protections started appearing in the 60s and 70s, and that law has continued to evolve. And now we have HIPAA. You all have to sign that when you go to the doctors. No one can see your medical records. And actually, so a lot of the records at the Kennedy Library are Rosemary's medical records, which I'm not allowed to see. For me, though, I don't need to know what a doctor in 1935 diagnosed her with. It's not going to be helpful to me. And so those private things are hidden.
I'm surprised they're hidden, though. I mean, just because HIPAA wasn't around then.
But HIPAA applies back in time, right, yeah. You had a question back there?
In the very early years, is eugenics a foul in America?
Oh, yes, very much so. But it wasn't as popular as it was in Germany at the time, which, of course, Hitler was really advocating a lot of that. And so it's pretty horrifying. I talk about this in the book. Joe Jr. goes to Germany, and he sort of analyzes what the Nazis are doing. And he writes a letter to his father about how he thinks that eugenics program, where they're sterilizing people with disabilities and people who are gay, et cetera, he thinks it's a good idea. And that shocked me because he had a sister who was disabled. So it was going on here. And in defense of the Kennedys, they were nervous because the stigma attached to children with or adults with intellectual disabilities was horrific. We don't have it as much today. It's still there, but nothing like it was in the 1930s. But my problem is they had the resources to provide for Rosemary, and they decided to have her experimented on rather than using the vast resources at their fingertips to take care of her. Yes?
Electroshock was also popular back then. Did they do that?
I don't know if they did that on her or not. I have no idea. I know it's still used today in rare cases, and it's very effective. And also, getting back to the lobotomy, I have a friend who's a neurosurgeon, and he said that he doesn't want people to think that the lobotomy is a total failure because it is successful, and he's done a couple of them. I think they're done with lasers now, but insurance doesn't cover it. The doctor has to devote the time, the hospital, everybody has to devote and donate the time. And there are two like medical boards and a patient review board that there's this huge process that you have to go through in order to perform a lobotomy. And he told me about two patients that he performed them on, and they had been in psychiatric hospitals since they were children, basically living in straitjackets because they were so destructive to themselves and around them. And so he performed the lobotomies, and they came out of them liberated from whatever this mental illness was that they had, and both of them were able to get high school degrees, college degrees. One of them went on to get a master's degree in social work, and both of them were working and living independently. So I don't know if he didn't tell me about the ones that didn't work, but he told me that those two, so it does have its place, but it's very rare. Yes?
What is your feeling having gotten all of this research that you did, and then the way you introduced it in terms of your son being diagnosed with schizophrenia.
Right.
So you come to the end, you've written the book, I read a review of it, I think it was in the New York Times book review section. And if I remember correctly, that review was not as kind to Joe and Rose as you seem.
Well, actually, in my book, I'm probably not as kind. So I wrestled with it. I was harsh on them, and then my son was diagnosed, and the trauma that you go through. And then, as a parent, what you do for your child. And then I became critical of them again. Like, they had more money than God. I wish we had that money to provide for our son, but we don't. They did. They didn't use it. They could have used it. Why lobotomize her? They could have hired more women to live with her full time and fill her life full of fun things to do. But they chose to just hide her away. And I had a great aunt and uncle who had a son who was intellectually disabled, and they lived in Forest Hills right near the Kennedys, and their children were all the same ages. And they kept Michael home, and he participated in everything. They didn't hide him. He was part of their lives. I grew up knowing Michael as in, you know, he was much older. You know, it's, so they could, the Kennedys could have done it. They could have, they were so powerful, they could have done anything. Why lobotomize her?
Yeah, because in the review, as I remembered, I came away feeling that she was the sacrifice to the Kennedy tradition.
Yes, absolutely was the sacrifice. Yeah. Absolutely. He wouldn't have done that to any of his sons. Yeah. He would not have done it. She was expendable. And Rose let it happen.
Yeah.
She was so powerful in that family, you know, so we all know what Joe did. He was a lout. He cheated on her. He did whatever he wanted to do, but he gave her every single thing she asked for. He would not have said no to her if she said, don't do this surgery. And she claimed these different interviews that she had. One interview, she said, oh, I had no idea. Another interview, well, I was so disappointed when he did it. You know, all my hard work just went down the drain. She was very non-committal about the whole thing. But she knew. Now, did she say yes, do it? I don't know. But she did know about it.
So your evidence suggests she really didn't.
Oh, she absolutely, yeah, because she asked her daughter to investigate it. Yeah, yeah. Yes?
In all your research, did you ever get a chance to interview any of the candidates?
So I tried to interview Teddy and Eunice, but they died. They were sick, and I wasn't allowed to see them. I tried to interview Jean, and she said no, and Ethel. Ethel has said no. So I interviewed the Shriver boys, and they were very nice, very helpful. When I talked to them, they basically, well, they did say, we don't know what happened to Rosemary. It would be really nice to know. They actually said that. However, not all members of the family felt that way, and they threw up a lot of roadblocks in trying to access those papers at the library. And because I was working on Rosemary specifically, there were papers that I was denied, whereas other historians could look at them because they weren't working on Rosemary, which made no sense. So the Kennedy Library is a National Archives institution. It's staffed by federal employees, paid by our tax dollars. So finally, I sort of had to start pushing on that fact in order for them to finally say, okay. And the library, the staff is fabulous, by the way. They wanted me to have access like other historians. So finally, I got access to the papers I needed to see. But it's an ongoing issue at that library, access to all the papers.
Mm-hmm. Have you heard back from any of them after having read the book?
I have not heard directly. I don't expect I will because that's the way they are. But I have heard from people that know them, that are close to them, who have said the Shriver, Anthony Shriver, supposedly is happy about the book. I would imagine because he gave me permission to use the pictures and I sent him a manuscript copy, so. And then Patrick Kennedy, interestingly, I heard from friends of his, and they said he thought it was very good too. He was happy with it. And his book about his experience with addiction and mental illness in the family came out the same day mine did in October. And I felt so badly for him because he exposed some of this mental illness and addiction issues in the family, and some members of his family rejected him. And that was, I can't imagine, excuse me, the struggle that he has to go through facing family members that are not supporting him. But if it happened to him, you can imagine how historians who are trying to piece those stories together have to deal with the family. Any other questions?
Where's she buried?
Mount Holyhood Cemetery in Brookline with her parents. Okay. Yeah, she died in Jefferson, Wisconsin, but they shipped her back here to Massachusetts. 2006.
Yes.
Yeah.
Did she die from?
2005 she died. I think it was just like old age. There wasn't anything in particular that I could see. Just, and Teddy, Jean, and Eunice were with her at the time when she died in the hospital. Yes.
If Patrick had mental health issues, could this have been a genetic thing?
Well, he speculates that. He also speculates that that his father and other siblings suffered from post-traumatic stress. He links it to the assassination of the two brothers, but I point back earlier to Rosemary disappearing, because if Teddy remembers that he was petrified at 9 years old when she disappeared, and then Eunice didn't dare ask for 10 years what happened to her sister, you know, that causes trauma. And as a matter of fact, I talk about this in the book, that Eunice was in school at Manhattanville that fall, and she did not go back to school after Christmas. She got really, really sick. She had Addison's disease, and it flared up dramatically that fall after Rosemary had the lobotomy. And then her mother sent her to Stanford University, and Rose moved out there and lived with her in the dorm, went to classes with her, ate with her, to get her through school. So here, I think, is another traumatized child from what they did to Rosemary. Her closest sibling, Eunice, was traumatized. So I think there's this trauma in the family of holding secrets, being afraid, what would happen if you spoke the truth. That's a lot to carry in a family, an awful lot. Just my, you know, psycho babble, whatever. Yes. I've started researching a topic. I'm just not feeling it yet, so I'm not sure what I'm going to do. I have to feel it, you know, right here. Yes?
As an author, where is your favorite place to write?
I have an office in my house that has big windows that looks out on the front yard, so that's my favorite place to write. And I wish I could write another book based on research at the Kennedy Library, because it is a beautiful place to research. It's just fantastic. The staff is amazing. The collections are beautiful. But I think I'm done with the Kennedys for now. Any other questions? Well, thank you very much.